Well, good morning, North Shore family. How is everybody doing on this rainy, cloudy Sunday morning? Good. Oh, I got some thumbs up from the littles back there. Awesome. Man, it is good to see you guys. Thank you for braving the weather and coming out and being here. And those of you joining us online, it's good that you – I'm so glad that you join us the way that you can. I know the Petties are at home. I know Mindy had a successful gallbladder surgery a couple days ago and is recovering from that, doing very well from what I hear. And, man, it's just good to see everybody here and to get together to just praise and worship God and learn a little bit more about his character and about his love for us. So that's what we're going to do today. We're just going to jump into some praise and worship, some music. I encourage you to sing along if you're at home and you can stand up in your living room or in your bedroom or just whatever, kind of put the distractions aside and join in with the music today.
Started, you complete.
good to know that we can trust God for what he says. We can take him at his word. In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation we believe. Oh, we believe in this broken. For just a moment.
Well, good morning and welcome to everybody. Kind of a rainy day, but glad that you're here. And those joining us also online, to Linda and the Petties, to Rita, to Donna, God bless you, to Dana and Lana and the kids, to the Spaldings, good morning, Bob and Monty, to Laura, to Kim and Maggie, and others, and thank you. We still have others coming in, and we want to say God bless you, and thanks so much for being with us and celebrating the Lord's goodness even today. Several prayer requests that we could encourage you, if you will, to pray for us. And again, as we list these out, if you could just pause and pray for them now. and let us be responsive to that. Mindy had a successful gallbladder surgery removal and all that, and is recuperating at home and is doing as could be expected, and praying her continued health and recovery. So would you pray right now for Mindy? Thank you. And Kim's cousin's wife, Christy, is in need of a liver transplant. And so if you could pray for that situation right now. Amen. And Laura Blomgren, her foot infection is back, something that she's been battling on and off. And it's a frustrating thing. So would you just pray for Laura this morning? Amen. And Danny, who works for Brian, is they're calling in hospice, and so it's been a kind of a lengthy battle with cancer, and so just praying for that family. And just one last one. Maybe you've got something going on, or you have something not mentioned, or I just see and know there's other needs. Can we just pause and pray for those needs, whether it's for someone else or even for your own heart in this moment, that we would allow God to speak to us and do a work in us. So let's join together in praying. Lord, I recognize you know the needs and concerns of our heart. You know ultimately that in you we can even be satisfied. Lord, there are so many distractions by health, mentally. Lord, whether it's finances, Lord, things that are a burden at work, relationship issues. Lord, we come right now and in an act of surrender, just open our hands from those things in this moment and just say yes to you. I pray your blessings upon your people and just invite you to speak in such a way that I will both listen and respond to you. May your word show its power in these moments. May the Spirit move us to action, all for your glory and for your grace. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your love for us. And that because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, we can have hope this morning. We can be renewed. We can be refreshed. We can trust in you when we even don't feel like it. I pray that you would be with us as we continue this very important conversation, and that you would encourage and build up the saints for your glory. We pray this all in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. If you would stand as you're able to sing with us. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises that cannot fail, when the howling storms of doubt and fears assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Promises of God, standing on the promises I now can see, perfect present cleansing in the blood for me, standing in the liberty where Christ makes free, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises. promises of God, my Savior. Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful. Won't. won't fail. No, he won't. Amen. Letting go of every single dream, I lay each one down at your feet. Every moment of my wandering never changes what you see. I try to win this war, I confess. My hands are weary, I need your rest. Mighty warrior, king of the fight, no matter what I face, you're by my side. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Truth is, you know what tomorrow brings. There's not a day ahead you have not seen. So in all things be my life and bread. I want what you want, Lord, and nothing less. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, you are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. You are my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. Your ways are always higher, your plans are always good. There's not a place where I'll go. You are my strength. You are my strength and comfort. You are my steady hand. I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out to you, I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. When you don't move the mountains, I'm needing you to move. When you don't part the waters, I wish I could walk through. When you don't give the answers as I cry out, my strength. to move when you don't part the water. I wish I could walk through when you don't give the answers as I cry out to you. I will trust, I will trust, I will trust in you. Yes, I will trust in you. Trust in you. We know that we have a firm foundation when we put our faith in you, when we put our hearts in your hands and our lives, and we seek after you first. We are standing on the rock, a firm foundation. God, we can trust in you. Even when things seem to be out of control from what we can tell, you have never wavered. God, you are strong, you are mighty, you are a creator. And God, you love us. And you want that relationship with us. And God, we say we are yours. And God, we take you at your word, the promises we find in your word, God. We take them, we stand on them, and we step forward in the truth that is you. It's in your name we pray this morning. Amen. Thank you so much for singing with us. Have a seat.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Anchoring your heart to God, even when you don't feel it. You been there? We're having an honest conversation that we started this last week. And whether you're joining us here or online, I think that God has this ordained, a conversation that we need to hear. And so I would impress on you just to hone in on what God has for you. Even today. Have you ever felt that? I mean, you're trying to anchor your heart to God, but you're just not feeling it. Well, it's important for us to have that conversation because, I mean, many of you even thought it this morning. You know, there were some people that, you know, were sleeping in their nice, cool, you know, warm, comfy bed, and the alarm went off, or they went like this, and they went, "Did I hear a raindrop?" And, you know, because there's this battle to go, okay, consider my circumstances and consider my feelings, and, you know, maybe I should just follow them. And then what happens when you just don't feel it? Now, we've talked about it. Life can get pretty complicated, right? Anchoring a boat can get complicated. I'll remind you again from last week. So I have a kayak, a little kayak, and I'm like, okay, so I need to figure out an anchor. And you would think, okay, that's pretty easy. You just get one of those things that looks like this and, you know, tie something to it and drop it over, and you got it anchored. And then I got to looking at it, and anchoring a boat is like this complex thing, okay? You have to figure out how heavy the vessel is, how deep you want to anchor it in, and then you have to figure out not just that, but what kind of bottom. And then that kind of bottom that you are most likely going to be anchoring to determines whether you need a fluke anchor, a claw anchor, a plow anchor, a mushroom anchor, or a pole anchor, or a combination of the above. You know, and then once you get that, then you do this math calculation where you figure out how much is above the tip of the boat to the water, and then from the water down to the bottom of the the bottom where you're trying to anchor needs to be a 5-to-1 ratio, unless there's wind. And then you do 7-to-1 or even 10-to-1. And so, you know, under normal calm conditions, if I anchor my little bitty kayak in 20 foot of water, I need 100 foot of rope and chain. You go, wow, that's a lot more complicated than just having go get an anchor. And isn't it interesting? You can have an anchor and just not use it, huh? I mean, does an anchor do you any good if you're, I mean, you have every intention of anchoring. You think anchoring is a great idea. And I mean, you even been people that anchor, and you don't anchor, you're not going to stay still. Or maybe you just let your anchor out a little bit and just let it dangle there. Is it going to do you any good? No. That's why we needed to have this important conversation. And last week we said, the tides of our circumstances and our feelings are deceptively rising to anchor our hearts to things that are lies, to warp our identity. And we had an honest conversation about this. We said, okay, there's lies out there that are pushing us to say that you're not enough and you don't do enough and someone else should define you and your past disqualifies you. And in the process of having an honest conversation, we said, you need to act on your true identity. And that's why it was important for us just to come back to the Word and see what our true identity is, because there will be times when you just don't feel like it. And you still need to put anchor down in what your true identity is. And we just had a real honest conversation of how do you do that? You spend time with the Master who created you and that formed you and that is constantly able to whisper your true identity. But that's not all, is it? I mean, you just avoid these lies and then everything's good. Your circumstances go, a little haywire and you go, okay, I recognize that. I'm not feeling it, so I should still act on it. Because that's tough. You know, not only does the tide rise, what happens with the tide? It falls. I mean, so one of the verses that maybe you've heard or you know, or you could say, maybe you've got it closer than you think. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. You know, I've never met a person that went, that's terrible. I mean, everybody goes, yeah, that's a good one. I mean, you should make a mug or a tattoo on that, huh? Whatever it takes, on something like that, because that's just like a guiding principle. But what happens when the tides of circumstances deceptively drop? And distract you from the what I would call dashboard warnings. Now, I have an old truck. It's about to be 15 years old. I love it. Every time I turn it on, it's a new Christmas tree of lights on the panel. Now, sometimes I go, woo, it's just yellow. Or I turn up my radio. Come on, you've been there. How about spiritually, those things that pop up that maybe God's trying to send us a little warning, a little something to remind us that you're anchoring to something that's pulling away from your trust in him? Well, if we wanted to have an honest conversation, we need to think about some of those things. I mean, the first thing when you start any car anymore, the thing that starts blinking at you is the fasten your seatbelt, fasten your seatbelt, fasten your seatbelt. And it'll just, they have it programmed where it'll just irritate you if you don't fasten your seatbelt. It's there. I wonder how many times God is telling us some little reminders, maybe even in this moment where the Spirit goes, that thing you've just been putting off, and when it gets more convenient, or you're not addressing that, and the Spirit's just going, why don't we address these things so that you can go on living life like God intended? And instead, we just settle for leftovers, huh? We sang the song, or maybe you attended church, or you listened to a podcast, and we just settle for less leftovers. Or maybe you've got that flashing light in your life of maintenance required, and you just go, well, that's a yellow one. It's not red. Red means bad, So maybe it's just a yellow. And there's been some things that you would go conviction wise. If I were just honest, I've been drifting a little bit on. And I've been a little lax on. And it could be anything. It could be everything. But I don't have to mention it, do I? And you just constantly have those things that are little warning signs from God's going, you're trusting in something else. You're trusting in your feelings right now. And, we're not supposed to be led by our feelings. They're real. And your circumstances are real. But if you're just following them, you're just missing out a little bit. Or maybe the brake light's been flashing. Because, I mean, it's gone, but you're just stubborn. You're going to drive anyway. I mean, and you can hear the grinding going on. Isn't it just like those moral convictions that we just know they're there and we step across anyway? You go ahead and say it anyway. You go ahead and do it anyway. Sometimes it's in front of people. Sometimes it's in the secret. But you're just stepping across those things. Why? Because you're just not feeling it right now. Isn't that an excuse that we all have used at times? Maybe your battery's low. You're just worried to death. You've been full of fear. You are prayerless. And what's been or could be driving you, all is just saying that it's numb, that it's about to be dead life. Or maybe your oil's a little low. You're impatient. You're controlling. Or the worst one, maybe your check engine light's not just flashing. It's on. And it's red. And you're living in that fear that it could give out any second. What are we talking about? Somebody that just is living without hope. This morning, we're all faced, regardless of what's flashing on your spiritual dashboard, will you take God at his word? Let's come back to it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he'll make your path straight. Again, none of us would say, that wouldn't help me out. That wouldn't be great looking in my life. Well, why don't we, for a moment, consider how we could take God at his word and let's live this out. John MacArthur said, our decisions, attitudes, and behaviors are determined by one of two things: external pressure or internal principle. Soak in a little bit more. All of our decisions, attitudes, and behaviors are determined by two things: external pressure or internal principle. So if I'm moving based on what culture's telling me, I'm doing it by external pressure. If I'm doing it based on what external pressure's causing me to feel, and then I act on it, I'm acting on just external pressure. If I've acted long enough on external pressures that I've made it my internal principle, but it's not, what am I still acting on? Some external pressure. How about we take God at his word and allow that internal principle to be our guide when we're in real circumstances and we get to the point, because we will, where we just don't feel it. There's got to be something that takes over that can guide us. Now, a very common story that maybe you've heard or you grew up in Bible school is Daniel. And I want to spend a little moment in Daniel this morning because I think there's some things that we can learn in that. In Daniel chapter 2, at the very end of the chapter, of course, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have been taken off into captivity. The world power at the time has come in and has deported the best of the best and taken them back to Babylon. And one of the things that they do is they immerse them in the culture and try to assimilate them both politically, religiously, and living just so that they will look and act and feel like them. And they had this brilliant idea that we'll take the best of the best back with us and educate them, and they can help us and enlarge our territories. And then maybe they'll let go of their traditions and their religious things and their political things, and just kind of, we can all become one, and we'll just take over the world together. And so they were living in this environment, it was Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had come with this amazing dream that he had, and he asked all the wise men, the magicians, all the smart people, and said, why don't you tell me what my dream means in Daniel chapter 2? And they went, great, tell us what it is. Tell us what your dream is. And Nebuchadnezzar went, if you're that smart and you're that can figure things out, why don't you tell me what my dream is and then tell me what it is? And if not, we're just going to kill all of you. Great, this guy Interesting guy. Okay. And so they're rounding people up because they're going, well, nobody can do that. And Daniel goes and says, can I get the king's audience? And the king gives him an audience, and he says, could I have some time to seek the Lord? And he goes back to his buddies, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and he says, pray, dude, pray, or this is going to be the end. And it was during the night. God decided to show Daniel the dream. And he goes back and he tells, Nebuchadnezzar is just blown away. And Daniel chapter 2, verse 47 through 49, the king answered and said, Daniel, truly your God is God of gods and Lord of kings and revealer of mysteries, for you have been able to reveal this mystery. Then the king gave Daniel high honors and many great gifts and made him ruler over the whole province of Babylon and the chief prefect, all of the wise men of Babylon. It continues on verse 49 and says, and Daniel made a request to the king, and he appointed Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego over the affairs of the province of Babylon, and Daniel remained in the king's court. So all this happened because they trusted God. Isn't it interesting that God revealed something that was not even known and told what was, and what was the king's response? Dude, you are plugged into the right guy. But did the king ever go, dude, that's so amazing that I'm going to take it on for myself? It's a warning sign for us. It's a warning sign, a dashboard. You can actually respect God and not trust God. And so you can sing the songs, and you can agree with Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, and you can share these things and not bring it in close and act on it. And so what is the Lord reminding us even this morning? Be careful of just agreeing and saying and debating over it. And, oh my, do we see this all the time online? Or yesterday, after some football games, and the coaches are like, oh, I just believe in God so much. And then they were like, F in this and F in that. I'm like, come on. There's something not connecting here. It's like, stop, don't say anything. You can tell there's a disconnect. I respect him. I think that, but there's not anything that's guiding you. So we start on the next chapter. King Nebuchadnezzar. I mean, can you believe this? After recognizing that you're the God of gods and the Lord of lords, when he interpreted that dream, he was told that you would be this head of gold. And no, in his own mind, he went, did you say gold? Did you say head of gold? You know what we ought to do? Let's just make a full statue of gold because I'm that bad. King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold whose height was 60 cubits in its breadth and 6 cubits. Remember, cubits from right here, elbow to top, is about 18 inches. So we're talking about a 90-foot tall by 9-foot wide statue. A telephone pole is usually sitting up about 45 feet, so double that in this plain of Durham in the province of Babylon. The king, he set this up, and he gathered all his satraps, his prefects, his governors, his counselors, the treasurers, the justices, the magistrates, and the officials of the provinces to come to the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. I mean, the officials from the top to the bottom, he invited in to be a part of this journey. Why? Because he wanted them to see his brilliance and to really test their allegiance. And so he said, the herald proclaimed, you are commanded, O peoples and nations and languages, everybody, when you hear all the sound, and he goes through all these instruments, and every kind of music, you are to, at the cue, fall down and worship the golden image that the king Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall immediately be cast in a burning fiery furnace. Now again, we're all responding, they were too, to either external pressure or internal principle. What do you think that the majority of people went? We're going to lose our job and our head today? when he plays that music, I'm tapping. You know, God forgive me. And isn't it amazing how when we're working on external pressure, we just start rationalizing, well, it'd be okay, and it would do this, and all these things that come up. And there's another little dashboard warning sign that comes up: be careful and don't trust cultural standards. Just because everybody agrees on it, just because everybody thinks that it's something archaic that God must have just meant for people back yonder, be careful of that. Why? Because it's trying to erode your trust in God. Isn't it amazing that even the group had gone to such extent that Hananiah, which means God is gracious, was renamed Shadrach, inspired of a coup, which was a god of the Babylonians. We don't even know their real names most of the time, do we? Mishael, whose name meant who is what God is, to Meshach, belonging to a coup. Azariah, God has helped, to Abednego, to servant of Nego. And they were just trying to rebrand them, not something big at the time, but just a little bit, just to pull them off center, to pull them off center, to drop them, their guard, if you will, from trusting in God and his standards. That even in a foreign place, and even when you just don't feel like it, and even when nobody else around him, that we can still trust in God. It goes on and says, well, therefore, at the time, certain Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. They declared to King Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever. You, O king, have made a decree. And he made the decree, okay, when the sound comes, everybody's to bow down. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they didn't bow down. And everybody went, there are certain Jews you have appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men do not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. And one of the dashboard things that we need to get onto and be honest about is when you just get stuck complaining. You know that type of complaining where you rant and you don't feel any better when you get done? In fact, when you start complaining, it just makes you madder. Have you ever been in one of those cycles? You complain, and then when you're done, instead of like, okay, I expressed it, I should be better off, you're just like, then you're really worked up. And then you're not going to sleep. And then you're like, now I don't care. Yeah, I mean, you just start acting out on all your feelings. Now, I want you to hear me very clearly. Hear me very clearly. Do you know that you can complain and it be biblical? What? Get in on that. That's what we're going to talk about all next week. Because the Bible actually gives us a way to lament in a way that turns us to trusting God. Oh, it's going to be a powerful lesson that we all need to hear. Because in the Psalms and in the Lamentations, it gives us a pattern for being able to complain, but not just get stuck complaining. You know, there's a difference. Stuck complaining, I just feel bad about myself or worse about myself, and I never get off of it. And it just makes me madder and angrier and don't sleep, and I just get caught in the fear. And so if you're stuck there, that should be a warning sign, if you will, that you're not anchoring your trust in God. At some point, there has to be a choice, if you will, to move from expressing your very real circumstances and feelings, and will you choose to trust in God through it? Oh, it's going to be a powerful time next week. But what happens if you just find yourself stuck complaining and ranting online? That should be something from the Spirit just going, you're not really anchoring in the truth. That's what they were doing. So Nebuchadnezzar, they were brought before Nebuchadnezzar. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he gave them one more chance. Now, if you're ready, when you hear all of this stuff again, we're going to play you the song. And after you play the song, fall down and worship the image I've made. That's going to be well and good. But if you do not worship, you will immediately be cast into a burning, fiery furnace. And who is God who will deliver you out of my hands? Boy, he's thinking big of himself, isn't he? Have you ever just got stuck fearing the what ifs in life? Christine Kane said, one of the signs we might be walking away from trust and moving over into fear is when all the what if questions start coming. What if the plane will fall? What if this is seriously really wrong? What if I lose it? What if I don't get it? I mean, have you ever caught yourself just where you're in a mental gymnastics just going, well, what if? Isn't it easy? And how that pulls us away from trusting in God to just trying to control the situation? When the what ifs start, we can drift not only into our thinking, but in everything our thinking affects, our decision making, our sound judgment, our responses, our beliefs, our emotions, our perspective, and even our physical bodies. This might be a warning sign if you're stuck in the what-if zone that you're not anchoring your trust in God. Now, maybe you know the story. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were faced with this before King Nebuchadnezzar. And what did they do? They somehow, by God's hand, acted on God's principle. And when they were given the choice to answer, verse 16 through 18, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered, O king, we have no need to answer you in this matter. Now, they were not being sarcastic at this point. They were just like, honestly, we have nothing to say. If this be so, how would life change if we lived that way? Huh? Instead of what ifs, how about even if, what if God acted? What if God showed up? What if God did something? But even so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. Something that's important for us to remember. Rick Warren said, not everything in this life has a happy ending. But this life is not the end of the story. Huh? And these guys knew in following and trusting Christ that their life was in God's hands, both now and forevermore. And there is something about living that way. I wonder if they had available that they drew to mind Isaiah 43. But thus says the Lord who created you, he formed you. Fear not, I've redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, they shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. So, just to sum up, there might be some warning signs that we're lacking trust in God. Maybe we're just respecting God without personal trust, or we're trusting cultural standards, or we're just stuck in the complaining zone, or we're fearing what if. Well, how can we take God at his word, even when we don't feel it? Do you know that it's down to a choice this morning? A choice to say yes to God and his word. I trust in the holy character and nature of God who is love and is just, 1 John 4:8, 1 John 1:9, who is all-knowing, who is all present, who is all powerful. 1 John 3:20, Psalm 46:1, Daniel 2:21. I trust in salvation by grace through faith in Christ alone. Ephesians 2:8 and 9. Colossians 1:13 through 14. He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and has transferred us to the kingdom of the beloved of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. See, trusting God is not what you think is the outcome, but it leads to fearless living. We can be delivered from the fire, and our faith will be built. We can be delivered through the fire, and our faith will be refined. We can be delivered by the fire into his arms, and our faith will be perfected. And as you lean on God, again, I trust God who is good and does good, Psalm 119, 68, and is working all things out for my good, Romans 8:28, no matter what is falling apart around me. Now, just to lean in again onto God's word a little bit more, Deuteronomy 31:6, be strong and courageous. Can you take God at his word? And you go, okay, I want that. Well, come on, lean into this. Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Hebrews 13:8, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, love, and self-discipline. Joshua 1:8-9, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. Then you'll do everything that's written in it, and you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Jeremiah 32:17. All sovereign Lord, you've made the heavens and the earth by your mighty power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. Psalm 119:105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light unto my path. Psalm 91:1-2. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge, my fortress. In him, my God, I will trust. Trust is a choice. Amen. It's a choice. Christine Kane says, when our thinking starts to be irrational, when our thoughts start dragging us down a road where we never wanted to go, when we feel helpless to stop and the unraveling that ensues, we're not trusting God. Are your circumstances very real? Are your feelings very real? And still, it comes down to a choice. Will we take God at his word? Can you read that part in blue with me? Blessed is the man who trusts the Lord, whose trust is in the Lord. He's like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and does not fear when heat comes. Its leaf remains green, and it's not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. Oh, I would pray that for your life and my life. How does it start? Where does it begin? Spend time with the Lord and take him at his word. What if you've got so many voices that you just can't hear? You need to double up. Come on, friend. You need to tune down the radio of other things. You need to put some things that are flooding your mind with what God says who you are. And maybe even as you lay down to go to sleep, that your mind turns on. Well, you need to turn something else on, the truth of God's word. And could I tell you, in this time and in this place, you and I, even if you've got it maybe a little bit together, maybe you don't have it any together, there are people around you who are dying to have a piece of God's word. And could you just encourage, even when you don't have very much in your bucket? Could you keep just telling, you know, I'm praying for you. I'm with you. I'm walking for you. I'm with you. And that we would be people who take God at his word. Seems so simple. It's not, is it? Does the enemy know where we're the weakest? Does the enemy know how to get us busy? Does the enemy know how to pop those lights up on the dashboard and just make us decorate them and just keep driving along and not paying attention to them? But this morning, by the power of the Holy Spirit, let's make the choice to take him at his word. Maybe there was a verse that jumped out at you that you need to just marinate over this week. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you for these reminders. I thank you that you meet us where we are. And even when our circumstances are ever-changing or difficult and our feelings are responding all over the place, that we can choose to anchor our heart in you. We can choose to trust in you. And is that easy? No, it's not. Is that a process that we have to go back to over and over and over again? It is. I pray that you would allow that to engulf who I am so that we move from just something that I agree with to something that's my internal guiding principle. No matter what comes up, no matter what happens, no matter what I feel, I will trust in you, God. You are the Almighty, the one who loves us and always is good and just and right and merciful. You're worthy of our trust. Oh, may you find a heart that's willing to trust you today. For the person that maybe has never trusted you, God, allow them to hear your loving, beckoning call to come to you. They don't have to do it alone anymore. Lord, as we see those dashboard warnings this week, would you allow us to see them for what they are? How we're ignoring trust in you and make the choice to say, yes, I'm trusting you, God. It's in Jesus' name we would ask these things. Amen. As we continue the conversation here together, I want to remind you it's next week that Operation Christmas Child boxes are due. Whether you're here or you're around the country, you can put those together, and we'll be sending out reminders. You can go to Samaritan's Purse and find out the things that you should or shouldn't put that. And there are delivery points all over the country, so you can find one near you. Wanted to encourage you about that. Next week, the art of the lament. How can you biblically complain and not just get stuck there? It's a very important lesson that we're going to walk through and equip each other with this next week. So God bless you to those that are with us online. And those that are here, we're going to spend just a moment, if we can, and just process these things so that we're not just agreeing with it, but we're taking it out the door. So God bless you, love you, and we will be talking to you soon.